of how domestication might have occurred, and I just thought I'd mention a few of them. Frederick Stoner characterized both goat and sheep as crop robbers, which might give you an idea of how humans and animals may have, how humans and these goat or sheep may have come into more frequent contact with the kind of the advent of kind of crop management. You might have had more opportunities to kind of interact with sheep and goat on a daily basis due to the occurrence of grain within settlements, and that kind of leads to the opportunity for management. Others, such as Melinda Zeder, kind of have suggested thinking of the domestication of goat in terms of the prey pathway. So it's not a kind of commensal kind of it's a domestication process, very different from, say, that of dogs or pigs or more modern domestic species, such as many fish species. And then there's other models, but I'd just like to point out the idea that throughout the kind of the process, and it's not a binary question of whether something is domestic or wild, there is likely to be a growing degree of breeding control as humans exert who lives or dies and who breeds within a managed population. And there's also going to be less interaction with wild populations as, say, those wild populations increase in size or domestic herds are brought outside of their kind of natural range. And so again, this earliest goat management evidence kind of correlates with where there was a lot of hunting of Capra aegagrus, and some of the kind of the most robust evidence for management is found in the Zagros mountains. You might already be familiar with this, but this is kind of seminal work by Melinda Zeder and Brian Hess, which kind of I'll just give you the location of that of the site. This is work done at Ganjira, which is a kind of a tell within in the central Zagros Highlands, quite close to many other Islamic Neolithic sites. And so Melinda's work first demonstrated that rather robustly that goats show a very strong bimodal distribution in terms of the size of specimens. Males were clearly much larger than females in the bone remains that in their bone remain dimensions. And when Melinda examined archaeological sites from before the advent of herding, and then in the ninth millennium at Ganjira, she noticed that in general there seemed to be there's quite similar the overall profiles of the sizes of specimens of bone remains across these hunting sites, and then also Ganjira, whereas compared with a lowland site that is at least 1,000 years earlier in terms of 1,000 years later in terms of occupation, where the animals, the goat, appear much more domestically morphologically domestic, there has been a shift in this kind of highland to lowland transition towards smaller goats, smaller animals, where Ganjira they still seem morphologically wild. And the key breakthrough Melinda had was that she realized that there was a bias in the bone remains being examined, that there was many unfused bone remains of males being discarded, and that was actually creating a bias in the distributions that we were seeing. Whereas if you could, once males and females were separated in terms of the bones being examined and survivorship curves constructed, there was a clear excess of death in males rather than females around the age of 12 months at Ganjidara. So this was taken as evidence of kind of young male slaughter, whereas females were allowed to maintain as a breeding population to an older age. And that contrasts with the hunting side of Asiab, in which there isn't this sharp decline of females. So that's what the kind of archaeology says, that there's evidence of goat herding roughly around 10,000 years before presence with this selective slaughtering signal. And so we hope to kind of address this with address the overall process of goat domestication using ancient DNA. So the first question we asked was, what does the mitochondrial DNA look like? If you're not familiar with the mitochondria, it's an organelle within kind of eukaryotic cells, mammalian cells, which has its own genome. It's quite small. It's only 16,000 base pairs long compared to a kind of the nuclear genome, which could be 3 billion base pairs long. And it's inherited very simply, just as a complete molecule maternally. So mothers always pass this along to their children. And so it's an excellent target for sequencing of poorly preserved samples, like ancient DNA samples, as there's many copies of the mitochondrial genome within the mitochondria, and often many copies of a mitochondria within a cell. And when we recover mitochondrial sequences, we can then construct a tree or a phylogeny describing how the sequences relate to one another. And in general, there's kind of five of these kind of deep groups, which we call haplogroups within domestic goat, A, B, C, D, and G. And then F is something that isn't really observed in domestic goat. It's more wild goat associated. When we look at what the modern domestic goat mitochondrial distribution looks like, a single haplogroup is most frequent, haplogroup A. It's at roughly 92% frequency worldwide. And then you get a little bit of kind of geographic structure of the other less common haplogroups, with haplogroup C being more common in Europe, and then the haplogroup B, D, and G being present in Asia. So you might think, well, if we simply examine wild goat mitochondria, maybe we can learn something about the domestication and process. But unfortunately, that's quite difficult. This is kind of just a distribution of haplogroups in modern present day wild goat. And what's likely has occurred is that there's likely been human mitigated movement of animals of wild goat, which may obscure kind of past distributions of mitochondrial DNA. So the DNA, the mitochondrial genomes we see now might be distributed very differently than they were 10,000 years ago. So it's hard to draw these kind of inferences using modern genomes. So that's this is where the paleogeneticist says maybe I can do something. And again, this is definitely where I stand in, and this is this is when the photo actually has a use, and that's the small little bone here that my 4-year younger version of myself is holding. This is the betrothal part of the temporal bone, which has proven to be a really excellent reservoir of ancient DNA molecules, in that you can subsample the petrous bone and very easily extract DNA molecules compared to targeting postcranial elements. And thankfully, that has actually improved in recent years. Extraction methods have improved. We can target other skeletal elements and teeth, for example, and hope to extract kind of good quality DNA. But in general, the petrosal bone is still an excellent reservoir for DNA molecules. So this involves work in the lab, so extracting DNA over several days, using proteinase to release to break down whatever collagen is still present in the bone, and then sequencing the DNA that we managed to extract, and hoping the DNA that we extract is actually goat DNA. And then we spend most of our time staring at computer screens and trying to interpret the large amount of genetic data that we might have. And I just thought I'd mention my supervisor, Professor Dan Bradley, who's been kind of the architect of all of the studies I'm going to discuss going forward, and others in and many others in kind of the paleogenomic study of domestic animals. And so the science paper that Marjan kindly mentioned earlier, we generated 83 ancient mitochondrial genomes and then also 51 nuclear genomes. And nuclear genomes in general are a much, much richer source of kind of genetic information, as they consist of millions of independent data points, whereas really a mitochondria is only one data point. But they're still useful in interpreting kind of the genetic makeup of populations, as we'll see. So I've just shown, I'm showing here a map of ancient goat mitochondria that we sequenced up until 5,500 BC, and contrasting what we see in modern wild goat, in modern domestic goat, we see very, very strong geographic structure of the mitochondrial haplogroups, where haplogroup A is actually only restricted to Western populations, so West Turkey and Europe. And then the haplogroups, which are much, much less frequent present day, in the present day, such as B, G, and D, they're at a much, much higher frequency in kind of the Zagros region and eastward. Now, after this kind of 5,500 we see a collapse of the geographic structure of mitochondrial haplogroups. So haplogroup A is suddenly observed across the entire range of sites which we sampled as far as Uzbekistan. And so this is much more similar to the modern distribution that we saw in domestic goat. We can also examine the nuclear genomes, which, as I said, are kind of a richer source of genetic data. And we somewhat recapitulate the signal that we saw in our previous graph. So our diamonds here, our filled in diamonds, are Neolithic goat genomes. And the principal components analysis separates out our goat genetic diversity along a kind of Western to Eastern axis on within Eurasia. And then PC2 discriminates kind of African versus non-African goat. And while we see that the Neolithic populations are highly differentiated, again, these diamonds are quite far from each other, there is a kind of a coalescence in the post-Neolithic period, the squares here, the filled-in squares, which suggests that there's been some kind of genetic interchange between goat populations in the period after the Neolithic. So there's been some kind of movement of goat populations, maybe through trade or just wholesale kind of movement of herds. And we also kind of inferred a very important event in the history of domestic goat, and that's that wild Turkish bezoar, so wild Turkish goat, appears to have contributed to the ancestry of European goat. So even by the kind of by their introduction to Europe, roughly around 6000 BC, domestic goat had this kind of pulse of ancestry that came specifically from wild Turkish goat that was completely lacking in goat from, say, Iran or more eastward. And we've interpreted that as evidence of kind of restocking of herds in Anatolia following their domestication. So obviously domestication is associated with phenotypic change, and if we care about domestication, we really want to understand the basis of the phenotypic change between wild and domestic animals. So I thought I'd just kind of go through some of the, you know, some of the phenotypes that we see in goat that are pretty seen in the bezoar ibex, and that one of those is tremendous coat color diversity in managed herds, horn-shaped diversity, and also some like remarkable and quite odd kind of morphological phenotypes and hair phenotypes. Domestic goat are also remarkably, you know, adapted to very diverse environments, and as well as that, they show features of domestication syndrome, such as a general kind of reduction in size and behavioral changes. So we hope to use genetic and the genomes we generated here from these ancient populations to try and infer if we could see any of the signals associated with these with these phenotypic changes. And so we took an approach called an FST outlier approach. FST is a measure of genetic distance. And what we tried to do was identify regions, windows in our Neolithic genomes, which were very divergent from wild genomes. Now, unfortunately, we only really had a large number of modern wild genomes. And in an ideal world, you would have a large number of ancient wild genomes to make the comparison fair. So we took eight of our better kind of Western genomes. So these were mostly, I think mostly Serbian genomes, and then six Eastern genomes, mostly from kind of the northeast of Iran. And then we just calculated in windows genetic distance and then also genetic diversity. What we wanted to find was windows which were very distant between wild and Neolithics. And then also in our Neolithics showed very little genetic diversity. So these might represent when, regions of the genome which have been strongly selected, you know, that which were under strong selection in our Neolithic goat. And using this approach, we actually identified a few regions which had kind of compelling evidence for selection. So we found seven regions in our Western group and twice as many in our Eastern group. And two of these regions were actually present in both the Western group and the Eastern group. One of those overlapped the KIT gene. And the KIT gene is a very well established gene infecting pigmentation in animals. And then a second region, which was upstream of KIT LG, so close to KIT LG. And KIT LG, again, it's it operates in the same molecular pathway as KIT, and it also has an effect on pigmentation. We all, within the selected regions, we also found genes associated with growth traits, fertility, milk yield, and also detoxification, which we thought might be associated with detoxification of fungal toxins present in grain stores. What surprised us as well was when we looked at the genetic structure at the kit locus, there seemed to be a very strong difference between the genomes that we the genomes from the Western population, so mostly Europe, and then genomes from the East. So we think that represents kind of selection for coat color traits kind of independently in Eastern populations and then separately in Western populations. And to follow up on this some more, we also investigated whether other coat color genes might have been under selection also. And in our Western population, we actually saw arguably three additional pigmentation associated genes, which showed quite high FST values. So they're very different from the wild goat genomes, and we've interpreted that as possible evidence for kind of human-mediated selection for coat color as early as the Neolithic period, roughly six, in the case of the samples, roughly 6,000 BC. And so from the study, we have hopes. Our main conclusions were that there's very strong kind of geographic or genetic structure in goat by 8,000 years before present, but with a role played by wild integration. So Anatolian wild goats seemed to have contributed some of their ancestry into Western European goat, and that might have actually contributed to the strong geographic structure that we saw, so such that the European goat looked more different because they had some of this ancestry, this Anatolian wild goat ancestry. But in general, our data supported a kind of main as a kind of a single kind of domestication event or process with this additional input into Western populations. And then following the Neolithic period, there seems to have been a kind of a genetic, some degree of genetic turnover, or at the very least, homogenization of these goat genomes compared to the Neolithic period. And that we also reported possible signals of selection already by the kind of the 6000 BC period. And so I'm just going to mention as well some work by Chinese colleagues, which I was involved in, which followed up on some of these on some of these findings. So they analyzed, and this is using modern data, modern genomes in an attempt to identify regions of the modern goat genomes which are under strong selection. And again, they kind of use this FST approach. So this is looking at genetic distance. And what they found was they found quite a few regions under strong selection, but two are very interesting. The first is this MUX6 gene. And MUX6 is thought to play a role in gastrointestinal parasite resistance. The second is STIM1 or M1. And if STIM1 specifically has a role in behavior and anxiety, and may contribute to the kind of the fight or flight response, which would make sense to see in a kind of a domestic animal compared to a wild one. But it's the MUX6 gene, which I'd like to talk about a little bit more. So they found a very clear kind of dose effect of having the domestic MUX6 genetic variant in increased resistance to nematode infection. And when they examined the actual sequence of MUX6, which was under selection, they found the sequence to be very similar to that seen in Capra caucasica. So Capra caucasica is a different species of wild goat. So this is within the Capra genus, but not the species from which domestic goat were derived. There's two sister species, They're considered subspecies by some and distinct species by other by others, but they have quite specific distributions limited to the Caucasus Mountains in the present day. So it was suggested that this MUC6 genetic variant, which is selected for in modern goat, it might have introgressed from these tur species into domestic goat, and then provided kind of a selection benefit in terms of the resistance provided against parasite infection. Now, what was really fascinating was that this paper analyzed our ancient genomes in terms of which genetic variants that ancient genomes had, which were later fixed in modern populations. And what they found was the selected variants, the SIM1 variant and MUC6 variants, they seem to correlate with the appearance of haplogroup A. So that haplogroup that seems to have spread throughout Southwest Asia and globally, kind of following the Neolithic period, that coincides with the occurrence of these selected genes. So whatever process might have been happening may have also been passing along these useful genetic variants. And so we just recently kind of published a preprint, which has been accepted at eLife, that suggests a possible source for these genetic for the introgressed genetic variant at MUC6. And we've actually reported a novel lineage of the Capra genus in the Taurus Mountains of South Turkey, and that's quite distant from the Caucasus, where the tur are found. And so this novel group, which I show here in the bottom tree, the pink names, they appear to be a sister group to the tur species. So they're a sister to both East and West tur. And these specimens, again, attained just from archaeological faunal remains from directly cave, epipaleolithic site used by local hunters. Their genomes seem quite distinct from anything extant. And this lineage, which we called the Taurasian tur, might have been the source of the MUC6 genetic variants, which are then kind of swept across the domestic goat population and is now fixed in domestic goat. And so selection clearly has happened throughout goat's domestication history and might be linked to this kind of population change as well. And other species of within the goat genus might have contributed to this kind of overall process domestication over the last 10,000 years. But we haven't really talked much about the genetics of the earliest phases of domestication. Most of the genomes I presented so far have been maybe at oldest 8,000 years old, which is, you know, at least 2000 years more recent than those earliest signals of the domestication process of goat. So that brings us back to our hoof prints and the settlement from which the mud brick was derived. So I was fortunate enough to be part of a collaboration and to examine the kind of the genomes from Ganjitra, the goat genomes from Ganjitra. And this couldn't have happened without some very key collaborators, Marjan Mashkur, who you've already met, Melinda as well, Melinda Zeder, and then also Pernille Bangsford and Lisa Yeomans at the University of Copenhagen. And so our So our study, which was a kind of a genomics and archaeofaunal joint analysis, assessed both genomes and faunal remains from the earliest excavations at Kanchedra and a second site within the region, Tepe Abdul Hussein. And so we first reanalyzed kind of faunal remains from the first initial excavations at Kanchedra, and also some more recent ones done by Danish archaeologists. And we kind of replicated the signal of pronounced decrease in male survivorship past the age of 12 months compared to females. And this is something that we saw at every level within Kanchedra, as it's traditionally kind of broken up in five different occupation levels. And despite this signal of selective male slaughtering at Kanchedra, that morphologically these still appear to be wild goat. So these, their horn cores are quite distinctively the larger bezoar horn core shape and size. As part of this paper, as I mentioned, we examined another site which is quite close to Kanchedra, known as Tepe Abdul Hussein. It's roughly contemporaneous with Kanchedra, and so that's around the turn at the end of the 19th millennium BC, so roughly around 8000 BC and into the 8th millennium. This is actually a photo of Kanchedra. I think it's a mound of about 40 meters in diameter. And as I mentioned, it was excavated in both the 60s, 70s, and then also more recently. And then Tepe Abdul Hussein is more recently excavated, and I believe its mound is a bit bigger than Kanchedra, about 50 meters in diameter. At Tepe Abdul Hussein as well, the horn cores are quite clearly bezoar like as well. So morphologically, the goat here were also wild like. So we managed to generate genomes from 14 individuals from across Kanchedra and Tepe Abdul Hussein. Now, this is again a principal component analysis summarizing genetic variation of modern and ancient, both domestic and wild goat. And so from the kind of going left to right is western to eastern domestic goat variation. And then going from the bottom of the plot up is kind of wild domestic variation. And so we found two clear clusters of goat from across the two sites. So we found one, which we called kind of the Zagros main cluster, which were much more similar to domestic goat. And then a second cluster, which was much smaller, which we called the Zagros outlier group. And this outlier group is represented by one genome from both Kanchedra and Tepe Abdul Hussein. So it's kind of it's a cross-site phenomenon. And this outlier group, just from examining the PCA, appears to have more wild affinity. The first thing I thought of was that this could be a kind of a diachronic signal. Maybe the outlier group represents kind of wild individuals prior to the establishment of the settlement. And so these are calibrated radiocarbon date curves. And the two samples with the orange arrows are the two outlier cluster members. And the remaining samples are from the main cluster. And in general, the The outlier genomes do overlap with at least one of the south crust main cluster. So we interpreted that as this is unlikely to be a diachronic signal. These two genetic clusters likely kind of existed at the same time at Ganchidra and Tepeydril Hossein. And when we kind of construct a tree to relate our genomes together, this is again using whole genomes. What we found was the main cluster is kind of a sister group to all other domestic goat, both modern and ancient. So that's this group in yellow. And then the outlier genome included in this tree is kind of the next sister group. So despite looking more wild, well, not despite looking wild, more wild, because it lo looks more wild, this tree model appears to be consistent with that observation, where the Ganchidra and Tepeydril Hossein goat are kind of basal to domestic goat variation, and then the outlier group is kind of more, is just one step removed from those more domestic-like goats. And then we could also explicitly test whether our outlier genomes appear to carry more genetic variants associated with wild goat. And the top two rows here are these tests where we tested explicitly. Does our genome have more or less wild genetic variants? And there's a very clear signal that our two wild, or sorry, our two wild-like outlier genomes did in fact have more wild genetic affinity, and it wasn't necessarily a technical signal. And so we interpreted that as kind of the persistence of hunting of wild individuals as we had the presence of these more genetically domestic managed individuals, which we inferred were present from the the archaeological faunal remains. And so we can look at our data in different ways, and in general, again, this kind of updated data with genomes from Ganchidra and Tepeydril Hossein still fits in with this kind of single branch, this single branch of domestic goat variation, fitting with a kind of a single domestication process with an additional contribution of Anatolian wild goat into the ancestors of West Eurasian goat. And so obviously these are morphologically wild goat, but their genomes look more domestic than we ever would have thought. They look like they're at the base of the domestic tree. We asked then, given that we had evidence of management at the site based on the kind of wild remains, could we detect genetic signals of management beyond just a kind of domestic affinity? Could early experimentation in herd management left traces in these goat genomes? And so we examined something called runs of homozygosity, and these are large regions within a genome which don't show any genetic variation in the kind of sample that we're looking at. And typically these are the result of inbreeding, so kind of kin breeding of related individuals, and this results in the same chunk of DNA being inherited from the parental line, maternal line, and it results in these large chunks of homozygosity, these large ROHs. And so we tried to examine our genomes and see if we could find these ROH runs, these possible evidence, possible signals of inbreeding. And in fact, we did see quite a few of them for some of our genomes from Ganchidra. So we then kind of asked, well, what about all domestic and wild goat genomes that we could analyze? And so just at the bottom plot here. This is a plot of the fraction of the genome which falls in these long ROH regions. And so we saw two of the four Sagar's genomes, which we could analyze, showed a really quite high amount of their genomes falling in these ROHs, which would be a somewhat compelling evidence for recent inbreeding. And that would fit with a model of selective slaughtering of males, because you're reducing kind of the breeding size population in a managed herd, and that should that should increase the amount of inbreeding you see. We also tried to measure heterozygosity, and that's just genetic variation. We were quite surprised that our Zagros goat genomes actually showed a surprising amount of genetic diversity. And it's surprising because you would expect that to negatively correlate with how much of their genomes were in ROH. As ROH, by definition, don't have genetic diversity within them. So yeah, despite that, they had a surprising amount of genetic diversity. And we interpreted that as a product of their still being within the range of wild goat. So these were being managed and were likely inbreeding as a consequence of that, but there was still a genetic exchange occurring with the wild, and later goat populations would have eventually been removed completely outside of the range of wild goat. And that might have substantially affected their genetic diversity, as there was fewer or no opportunities of restocking from wild populations. We also wanted to kind of explicitly look at the idea of males dying at a younger age with females surviving. And to do that, we looked at both the mitochondria and also Y chromosome. And Y chromosomes obviously are, as you should probably know, inherited from father to son. And so we hypothesized that if more males were dying at a younger age, there should be less Y chromosome diversity than mitochondrial diversity. And that's indeed what we saw. We in fact saw the entire range of the goat mitochondrial haplogroups within our Zagros goat genomes. Whereas for the Y chromosomes, for the few that we obtained from males, there was effectively just a single haplogroup observed. So that would suggest more genetic diversity in the maternal line than the paternal line, which is what you might expect from that the selective slaughter evidence from the archaeological fauna remains. And finally, we also tried to search for the genetic variants, which I mentioned, of the genes that were later selected in modern goats, fixed in modern goats. You might remember that's STIM1 and MUX6. And so what we found was the STIM1 gene, which may have a role in behavioral traits, did appear to be kind of present in our Zagros population. So they might have already carried the genetic variant, which would later be selected. And this contrasts with MUX6. If you remember, that's the one which may have passed from a different species of goat into the domestic gene pool, and our data completely fits with that model, as we don't see the genetic variant at all. And I'll actually also mention that we saw in general much less compelling evidence of selection from our Zagros genomes, which again might suggest that this is very early on in the management process, but that still there is some kind of consequence to management in the ROH and genetic kind of divergence that we had seen in the genomes, but selection may not have kind of started, whether intentional or otherwise. And so this is quite a nice example of how kind of archaeozoology and paleogenomics can kind of ask questions and inform each other and kind of test each other's results. So when we saw the differential survival of male and female goats, we could actually test that looking at the mitochondrial and Y chromosome diversity, and we saw that our kind of our data lined up, and that we already knew that there was probably ongoing hunting activities at both sites, and our genomes would kind of fit that, with most of the genomes showing much greater domestic affinity and a small number being more wild-like. And then as well as that, the kind of the big kind of headline result, I suppose, was that these were already, you know, within a region which showed the early, some of the earliest evidence for goat management, and our genomes kind of fit that. They were basal to at the very base of domestic goat variation. Now, I thought just to mention a little bit of sheep work that we were doing. There's only a few slides in this, as a lot of this work is not published. So I thought I'd talk a bit. Sorry, there's a little bit of noise in the background. If people could just mute. I was lucky enough to again be a collaborator of Merjan Mashkur. And this is more of a kind of a local study, which we hope can show what how paleogenomics can ask very specific questions in archaeofaunal research as well. So we examined a animal remain from the Duzlak salt mine, which is near Shahrabad in northwest Iran. It's quite famous for the salt men natural mummies, which have been preserved remarkably in the saline conditions within the mine. And so this is work primarily done by Connor Rossi, a PhD candidate within our group, and I was also involved as well. And among the many specimens which have been recovered from the Shahrabad mine, there was this kind of remarkable sheep leg. And we, in coordination with Marjan, we attained a cutting of the sheepskin and hair. We managed to obtain DNA from the skin itself. We found that compared to other relatively similar in age ancient sheep samples, the DNA fragments were remarkably well preserved in the sheep mummy, this salt sheep mummy. Suggesting that kind of the salt and hydrous conditions had really protected the DNA that was present. And so given we tried to kind of ask some kind of regional questions with the sheep genome that we had managed to recover from the sample. So we asked, well, how similar is it to modern sheep breeds? And this F3 statistic is just a measure of just genetic similarity. And we found a very clear signal of greater affinity with local Iranian and East Turkish breeds compared to, say, European or further kind of Central Asian breeds. We also wanted to try and address kind of phenotypes of interest, and wool was one we were really interested in examining. So the genetic background of wool, like the woolly phenotype, is not that well understood. We know of at least one region in the genome where a large insertion does appear to affect wool and contributes to a wool phenotype, though it's probably not the only genetic region. So we tried to examine and see if we could examine our genome for this insertion and whether we could infer whether the insertion was present in our sheep mummy. And we didn't actually find any evidence for the insertion being present. We only found evidence for it not being present. And so that would kind of fit with it being a woolly haired sheep rather than a hairy sheep rather than a woolly sheep, because we didn't see the presence of this wool insertion. We also performed a scanning electron microscopy on the remains of the hair itself, and they were consistent with the hairy rather than woolly phenotype, but a bit that this was from leg hair, so it might not actually well represent the coat of the animal itself. And then finally, we searched for genetic variants associated with the fat tail phenotype, which is quite frequent in Iranian and Asian sheep breeds. And we actually found evidence that carried our sheep mummy genome actually carried a genetic variant associated with the fat tail phenotype. And so this our kind of results kind of fit with what the archaeological interpretation of the animal remains were already, and that this was likely an animal present in the mine kind of for food supply rather than secondary product production. And so that kind of wraps up this presentation. I'd really like to thank Dan Bradley and all of the many fantastic collaborators I've had the opportunity to work with. And then I'm very happy to take any questions people might have. Thank you.